Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents I Am a Stranger Here Myself by Debra Gwartney. Narrated by Susan Ericksen. Therefore love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land. Deuteronomy, chapter 10, verse 19. They are strangers to the language and the manners, to the advantages and wants of the people whose lives they would model and whose evil they would remedy. Dr. Samuel Johnson. 1. The end of something. 1. A man is following me on US 93 in Idaho. His red truck, a firecracker in my rearview mirror. It's a rumbling diesel truck with a toothy grill and road-gobbling tires, and when the sun's rays tilt just right as we wend through the narrow canyon, the ram on his side panel glints like a neon sign. After about an hour of this guy on my bumper, I start to wonder if it's what he's planning to do to me. One good ram. I'm a little pissed at the bubble of fear rising in my throat. I should be able to hold my own, even on an isolated road in Idaho with brilliant sun splashing across an empty June day, but I don't like how near he is or how alone I am. I'm betting he spotted my Oregon plates and my I'm with her sticker and wants me and my kind off his road. It's not like he's honking or flashing his lights, but his truck is twice the size of my hatchback, and the rifle rack behind his head holds a weapon clicked in tight. Plus, the man keeps closing in on me. We're on a windy two-lane stretch between the towns of Salmon and Chalice, with no cars in either direction, when he looms again in my mirror and revs his engine. I think about sticking my arm out the window to flip him off, but instead I do what this Idaho man wants and pull over. I need to pee anyway, so what the hell? I tap on the brake and veer into a rest stop at the top of a piney rise. He roars off, and I step out on cracked asphalt, awash in frustration and disappointment. But disappointment about what, exactly? That he found me out? That he stared into the tan vinyl interior of this car with its fuel-efficient engine and pegged me as a late middle-aged white and left-leaning woman? Nail on the head, buddy. And it was the right thing that we parted ways, though I sort of wish I'd waved him over to park next to me so we could, I don't know, talk. Could we talk? Mostly, I want to let him know that I'm a fifth-generation Idahoan and have the right to drive along the river's edge and weave through the undulating landscape without someone pushing me to hurry along. I'd tell him that when I was a kid, with my father at the wheel easing through these same curves, I felt in my body every bend and straightaway from our house in Boise to Salmon, while smells of river and sagebrush and baked earth poured in the open window. I knew the drive by heart, but I stuck my face out anyway to imagine how all this around me was formed by a herd of lumbering dinosaurs that one day plopped down and turned into the tawny, mottled hills of eastern Idaho. But of course, when I was a kid, half dozing in the back seat of the station wagon, heading to my one and only best place on earth, I let myself believe a lot of things I can't anymore. It surprises me that I'm here again, staring out at the hills of my youth, the mahogany cliffs. It's an out-of-the-way place, our wedge of Idaho. I take a minute to soak it in. The wide fields below me dotted with black cattle and an occasional white-tailed deer. If I'm lucky, a few sleek antelope will happen along. If I'm super lucky, some clattering bighorn sheep. In the distance are gleaming mountains we sang about in school, a bright blue sky. I know the place about as well as the lines on my face. Would the truck driver, long gone down the road, care about this affinity of mine? Probably not. But I wonder what he might say if he were standing next to me. I wonder if he'd be willing to listen in a way most men aren't. Most men, all my life, certain they can tell my story better than I can. First, I would lay out my legacy. My great-great-great-grandparents who moved west and bore my great-great-grandmother Iona, who begat Lucy, who begat Lois, who begat my father Mike, who begat me. Every one of us an Idahoan. More Idahoan than the truckman, I'm betting. I like thinking, anyway, that I'm rare with my forebears showing up in the early days of the West. The town I've driven away from, Salmon, is where generations of my family lived from those early days until now, and it's also my birthplace. I've just spent 2 days there because my grandfather died. 2 days because I couldn't manage any longer, though I still consider the town my Elysium. Only in Salmon has my mouth slacked easy around the word home and its cousin belong. And yet I've itched at the same time, from babyhood on, with the rash of not belonging. For years I boomeranged in and out to see if I could get it right. Salmon is snugged into a valley, cupped by the bitterroots, the beaver heads, under a sky that fools you into thinking you are slung into the interior of an egg. I was held in just that way for a long time, believing the town had an innate ability to deliver up the truth about who I am. If the truck driver were standing next to me, listening to me wax on, he might scratch his head at this pronouncement and ask why I gave the place up if I claimed to love it so much. Didn't you forfeit everything that Idaho means by turning against it? It's true that I have never shot a gun. I've never stood behind a taut bow with an arrow aimed at an animal's heart. I have little use for horses and no gut for whiskey. I've gone 40 years without venison or elk or grouse on my table. I've let my skin wrinkle and my belly sag. Decades ago, I divorced an Idaho man who once marked the calendar with the days I owed him sex. I raised 4 daughters without once lamenting the lack of sons. What I have instead are Idaho stories that, knit together, would stretch as long as the highway to Boise. There's the one about my great-grandfather and my grandpa Bob at 9 years old, riding with those who shot the last wolves in the state back in 1925. I despise that story, but it validates the Idaho in me, and I would tell it to the truckman for that reason. I also have a photo of my maternal grandmother, Mamie, holding up a hooked steelhead, at least a 4-footer, and for a time, the largest caught in the Salmon River. I could tell stories about my great-grandmother's pies and biscuits and pots of stew cooked up for a table of 20 ranch hands, and how, 6 hours later, she would get herself up and do it all again. And I have tales about the men in my family who've set up hunting camp in the same place in the Lemmy Mountains for nearly 100 years. And you've been to that camp? I am forced to admit I have not. Then you've got nothing. Get back in your putt-putt car and go home. My made-up interlocutor is in his early 30s and wears Lee jeans tight enough to show the arc of his kneecaps, a plaid shirt, beat-up Tony Lamas, and a red ball cap. He returns to his truck dressed this way, shoulders square. He swaggers as he walks. A dip of chew bumps from his jaw. The confidence emanating from him, down to the dust clouds he makes with shuffling feet, illustrates the dilemma I'm in with myself. Where's my ease like that? My comfort with who I am and where I'm from? For reasons I have yet to decipher, I can't seem to make peace with the place I've loved best on this earth. 2. My grandmother, my father's mother Lois, is the one who loaded me up with myths and legends when I was a kid. She taught me the names of Lear's daughters and Hamlet's drowned lover. She read to me about gods and monsters. Every car we passed with the headlight burned out caused us to call out, "Cyclops!" Every jealous man in the Owl Club bar, she muttered hot in my ear, was another Iago out for blood. I loved those tales. I loved that she insisted I read Babar in French, though I spoke not a word, and that she encouraged me to read every Oz volume before I saw the film. Advice I did not heed. And yet the folklore that's mostly stuck with me has to do with the town she lived in, Salmon. Both her home and her trap, this burg in the mountains that she and I couldn't talk about honestly because, I think, so much of her wanted out and so much of me wanted in. Or was it vice versa? Back in childhood, when we were in Salmon for any stretch of time, my sisters and brothers and I might be invited to tag along with our cousins to the Carmen Grange on a Saturday night. Grandma Lois would drive us. They treated her kindly, but I saw how she sometimes confused the Carmen crowd. The way she'd get agitated, for example, over the apostrophes on an A&W sign. Fries, 79 cents, spelled F-R-Y apostrophe S, comma, dollar sign, dot, 79, apostrophe. Or her insistence on explaining, again, why you don't lay down for a nap. Grandma Lois's oldest son, my father, along with his wife and children, had moved to Boise so he could become the family's first executive for a corporation. He was the first man in our clan to toss off terms like pension and stock options. But, if I can speak for my siblings, we preferred our original home. In Salmon, I could head off in the morning to the newspaper office owned by my mother's folks and find my grandfather at the massive pedals of the printing press. He'd let me climb up and set my hands on top of his chapped ones as he pulled the levers. And later, he'd ask one of the operators at the octopus-like linotype machines to peck out letters in lead so I could stamp my childhood name on endroll paper. Debbie, Debbie, Debbie. Down Main Street at the implement store owned by my great-grandparents, my sister and I would swing, until we were chased off by our broom-wielding great-grandmother, from scales meant to weigh sacks of nails and screws. Our great-granddad, smelling of whiskey by mid-morning, was usually the one who plunked us on the cement floor and, with a big happy laugh, fished out a dime from the cash register so we could buy a pack of Juicy Fruit at the city newsstand across the street. We flew out the door, tinkling the bells that signaled customer. After the town siren blew exactly at noon, our Grandpa Bob might drive us in his scout truck up the scrub hills where he'd call to his horses, a whistle to bring April, Amber, and Crow in from miles away. I remember him dipping into a pocket for apples gone soft, giving them out to kids who wanted to feed a horse. "Keep it flat," our grandpa warned about outstretched palms. "Those fingers will get bit clean off." And on some weekends, we'd all drive out to Carmen, a few miles from downtown Salmon, sliding into the outlying ranching territory as if we were long-lost sheep. It struck me at age 9 or 10 that people at the Grange had a solid idea of what they meant. I saw it in the plain way they greeted each other. No hugs or pecks on the cheeks, but a nod, a grunted hello while Aunt Janice set down world-famous biscuits still warm from her stove and Uncle Jack stepped into a circle of men. Plaid shirts, the monotony of Wrangler jeans, felt hats clutched in their hands, and a stubborn line of sunburn across each man's forehead. My sisters and I followed our five cousins around the musty building, boards complaining under our feet, dipping into potato and jello salads, fried chicken you never wanted to stop eating. A handful of men sauntered to the stage, twanging on guitars and banjos, warming up, while teenagers moved shyly to the edges, gauging interest, working up the nerve for a dance. Soon these young people would be paired off for good, sent out to make a life prescribed by their parents and their parents' parents, whose ranching outfit was not a mile down the road, a life that began at dawn and ended long after dark, their compact homes with utility rooms in the back where milk cooled and separated in stainless steel buckets, where sick lambs were brought in for tending, or, if too far gone, dispatched with a twist of the neck. I realize it's my own long-held perspective, not theirs, that my ranching relations had something I didn't, a single road to travel down. In Boise, our parents were more unsettled than settled, and for many years we teetered on that edge with them. As a couple, they were driven to go after something better than what they'd had in Salmon, fancier, larger, shinier, whatever tangible evidence they could conjure to prove to everyone back in their small town that they'd made it big. It's not that I desired my version of what the ranch kids at the Grange had. I didn't. There was no missing the stifle of having your future handed to you like a plate of cold leftovers. But being around that measure of stability made me feel, if I recall correctly, lonely. Let's say that is my chief affliction, loneliness. Loneliness boiling up from an empty place inside of me. It has to do with growing up in what many still consider the deep backcountry, in a family steeped in the mythology of the West, square-backed men who were the embodiment of patriarchy and tough women who mostly kept trouble to themselves. As a kid, I lived in dread of letting down the men or failing to meet the standard of women carved into me like a talisman. Now it's too late to be one of those women from my past, nor do I want that. But what is it I need to remember about my grandmothers so I can finally be me? 3. Making up the truck man was just so much chatter inside my head after I pulled over and stepped out of the ticking car. I had to defend myself to someone, I suppose, in the wake of my brief visit to Salmon. I'd packed the back of the car with a small suitcase, a couple of my dead grandfather's shirts, and, in the passenger seat, books nabbed from long-dead Grandma Lois's library, a few of those having to do with the founding of the West. One in particular I planned on reading when I got home was a biography of Narcissa Prentiss Whitman, a woman I remembered learning about in grade school and who my four daughters learned about when they played the Oregon Trail video game at school in the 90s. I remember my girls hanging over the screen, strategizing to do whatever they could to keep their digital settlers heading west. Your wagon tipped over. Someone stole 6 of your oxen. You have died of dysentery. Something about Narcissa Whitman drew me in when I saw the book on my grandmother's shelf this time. She was the first Caucasian woman, so say the history books, to cross the Rocky Mountains, the first white woman to give birth to a white baby on the frontier, same history books, a missionary killed by the people she aimed to convert, her death, some say, changing the course of the settling of the West. I'd left Salmon agitated, looking for some way to get beyond the notion that I was nothing but a misfit in a town still ensconced in a cowboy ethos that held no room for someone like me. I suppose that's why I promised myself I'd get to my grandmother's book about Narcissa Whitman right off the bat, and would find other books about her too. Not so I could fawn, but so I could reject a woman I'd already pegged as odious. She was shaping up to be my ideal nemesis in the way she believed the land was hers to take, in her insistence that she alone held the one and only path to God. Putting an end to an entire culture was justified in Narcissa's mind as long as it was done in the name of progress and providence. I would let myself despise her for that squirt of narrow-mindedness and her proclivity to judge, even while managing to ignore my own such propensities. So what if she was trapped in others' expectations, her mother's and later her husband's, and also her times and her church's? I wouldn't forgive her for building a good part of her cage. I stood in the middle of the rest stop lot for longer than I meant to. I was alone in the cool forest breeze, a small creek gurgling not 10 feet away. I jumped a few logs in the woods to get to an even wider vista that opened up every pore of my skin, prickled the hair on my neck, lifted my heart. And I decided right then that this was probably enough. I'd found the perfect ending. I could go on home and call it quits with Salmon. Except for an old niggling need to stay put and meet the woman I'd have become if I'd stuck it out in Idaho. A woman who'd be skinnier and more burnished and could grill a steak to medium rare and, well, I don't know what else, because she's a balloon enigma floating just beyond my reach. I was pretty sure Grandpa Bob, dead for 3 days, would scoff about my rest area angst. "Damned useless meanderings of the mind," he'd say. "Just get yourself out of the bed before dawn, put in an honest day's work fixing whatever broken baler or wagon comes through your door. Challenge your kid to a game of horse if there's still daylight in the sky when you're back from feeding the actual horses. Read a dozen pages of Louis L'Amour while supper's put on the table. Head for bed at a decent hour so you can do it all the next day. There's a life worth living. What's your bother about?" I don't know. But I have to say, I was bothered. I got back in the car and was reaching to turn the key in the ignition when I noticed the book again. I picked it up and opened it to the title page. Narcissa Prentiss Whitman. A version of history set down in black and white, never to be altered. And hadn't I done the same with my own? Told and retold the stories of my childhood so often that the memories finally calcified. Probably time to break it apart. My own past, and, for some reason I had yet to decipher, hers. 4. Narcissa Whitman died alone, her body crumpled like paper, her head a cracked melon. She was shot a dozen times on a cold day in 1847, men whipping her laid bare back while she was still breathing. As darkness was coming on, as temperatures fell below zero, she was rolled into an irrigation ditch and left to die. The Whitman's compound in the broad Columbia Basin, about 8 miles from current-day Walla Walla, Washington, is where she was killed. A small band of Cayuse led the raid, having set their knife points and rifle barrels on the woman and on her husband, Marcus, though a pair of young girls died too, as did a dozen men and boys. The wrong place at the wrong time for that lot. One was Nathan Kimball, a man who'd left Missouri with a wife and $1,500 in cash and seven children until two died on the trail. Kimball had asked to overwinter at the mission. One heck of an ill-fated decision, with his remaining family, including other sick children, and on the morning of November 29th, he was one among a group of men stomping their feet to stay warm in the center of the compound. Their job was to butcher a steer, and they hoisted the dead animal on a derrick to make the first long cuts. They worked for hours, with few words passing among them. It was when they were finished, when they were cleaning up and distributing the dripping meat, that the first shot rang out. Kimball was as stunned and stock still as the others when the man next to him was hit in the chest and fell to the ground. Before he could think to run, Kimball was shot too, his arm broken and bleeding, but he managed to wrench himself away to fly toward the house with the mission's wounded scholar, Andrew Rogers, close behind. He crashed through the kitchen door, shouting to those holed up inside, "I don't know why the hell they're trying to kill me!" His statement made the children giggle, despite a kitchen splattered with blood, despite a boy in the corner with his throat cut, despite their patriarch lying before the fire mortally wounded, and the women clustered together in fear, as they were unaccustomed to hearing a man swear. Glacial temperatures had rumbled in a few days before the attack, encasing the compound in ice, doming it in a winter glow. This place, called Wailapu, the name Marcus gave his mission in the fall of 1836, to honor, he said, the native people whose traditional grounds he and Narcissa settled on. The word means home of the ryegrass people. Tall grasses and bulrushes, tall sedge that the Cayuse use primarily to cover their longhouses, were imperative to the tribe's way of life. A fact that Marcus, in what strikes me as one of his first acts of colonial indifference, ignored. In short order, the missionary man, doctor, burned great swaths of that grass, churned the rich soil, planted a large, cheery garden, set in an orchard of stone fruit and apples, and began sowing acre after acre of the white man's favorite grain, wheat. In the late 1940s, a visitor to the mission wrote in his travel journal that Marcus Whitman had planted a good 2,000 acres of crops, largely wheat, to provide for the mission. But back in the early months, when he was just getting started, Marcus wrote the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Mission with a shopping list. Send more plows. Send more tools for repair when the plows broke down. Send more wheat seed for the plows to plow under. Besides prodigious prayer and the lure of everlasting life, this is how he'd civilize the natives. He'd create an agrarian culture where none had existed. All my plans require time and distance, he once wrote. Be patient, that statement seems to emphasize, and I can make the impossible happen. Croplands lay fallow on November 29th, Marcus and Narcissa's last day on Earth. The mission's plows were piled like crooked spines in a shed, with 70-some souls in the compound moving as little as possible, huddling together against the cold. They scooted up near their fires and exchanged rumors about simmering discontent among the Cayuse. Some were sure an attack was coming, Marcus and Narcissa among that clutch. The couple had stayed up half the night, or so a survivor reported, speaking in hushed voices about threats that Marcus had heard while on the road tending to the sick. Cayuse men were on their way, and they intended to kill. Beyond her religious ardor, she was indeed a zealot. What Narcissa mostly did at the mission was organize each day so they could get by, storing food against rot and insects, plugging holes in shelters, gathering wood for warmth, providing never-ending care for the sick. Not a single volume I've read about the Whitman venture fails to mention the rampant illness. Narcissa was one of the few who contracted neither measles nor typhoid. Neither did Marcus. She did not come down with the dysentery or cholera that spilled from wagon trains that showed up almost daily after 1843, full of desperate overlanders, sick, hungry, lost. Week after week, wagons sought succor and food. The Whitmans provided both if they had the means and energy, and they almost always had the energy. But even if she wasn't pockmarked or burning with fever, Narcissa had her troubles. A deep ache in her chest that Marcus diagnosed as a heart ailment, for one, and in a letter home, Narcissa lamented that her eyesight, already poor, had failed another notch. The world around her was blurry now. She also fussed about her weight, 162 pounds, a fleshy softness that, she said, didn't suit her. My sisters would laugh. Plus, she had come to hate her job. Narcissa was slow to rise the last morning of her life. So unlike her, this stickler for the 4:30 a.m. recitation of scripture, this ardent keeper of schedules, that the children in the house were silent in astonishment, especially after one girl returned from the bedroom to report their steely matriarch was weeping. The dress Narcissa put on once she was on her feet, a dainty flower print that she'd once told her mother would please the savages, was crisp and freshly laundered. Of course, that was her standard. It was bath day, so she went to work filling tubs in the living room with hot water. She pulled pale girls, arms bent like snapped twigs, from their sick beds and laid them in the bath, scrubbed them apple red, and lifted them out again. Around noon, a small group of Cayuse men pounded on the kitchen door, a rustle of trouble on the porch that Marcus got up to deal with, and then came the first blast of gunfire. Kimball and Rogers stumbled in, shouting for help. Naked children, fresh from the bath and frightened by the screams of dying men outside, darted about the house screaming too, while Narcissa ordered them to get dressed immediately. She checked the doors, gathered the children to her, and eventually made her way to her living room window, a rare piece of glass that Marcus had bought for her through the Hudson Bay Company, trying to sort the mayhem outside. Who was dead? Her husband, for one. She'd already dragged Marcus into the living room from the kitchen after a tomahawk was planted in his brain. She'd packed the gash with ashes from their fireplace. He muttered a few words to her, and she knelt next to him, believing, for one disoriented split second, that he might survive the blade strike and the gunshot to his neck. But he died before the ashes cooled. She must have figured then that she'd be next. There was no way out. Although perhaps a sliver of hope, thin as an icicle beetling from her house's eaves, rose up in her. Perhaps she let herself believe that she and the 11 children under her charge might live on, if God so willed it. But then a pop and a burn at the top of her arm, as if it had been ripped from her body. She fell to the floor, pulling along with her a girl who'd been clinging to her skirts. The child had nearly been hit, too, by the ball lodged in Mother Whitman's shoulder, and they both cried out for being alive. "Hold me tight," Narcissa said, drenching the girl's dress in blood. The child and Kimball helped Narcissa upstairs to a small bedroom, where two other children were gripped by the worst of the measles. Their wounded matriarch was moved to the bed with them, while Rogers and Kimball and a few teenagers, the ones not hiding in a loft with the younger children, did their best to comfort Narcissa and staunch her bleeding. One of the instigators of the attack, a man called Tamsucky, who'd been fomenting revenge against the missionaries for a decade, called up the stairs to Narcissa. "They were ready to make peace," he said. "The killing was over." He and the others asked the woman to come outside to parley. The children begged her not to go. The two men in the room cautioned her against meeting with the Cayuse. "Not yet. Let things settle down first." Kimball had seen the carpenter, Peter Hall, run from the compound toward the fort. Maybe he was bringing help even now. But she sat up in the bed, holding a compress to her shoulder. "God has raised us up a friend," Narcissa said. Rogers managed to get her down the stairs. At the bottom, she fainted. From loss of blood, from the overwhelming experience of the last hours, from the sight of Marcus's now smashed-in skull. She was lifted, barely conscious, onto a settee, and Rogers took one end and a teenage girl the other until a man named Joe Lewis stepped in and moved the girl aside. The two men carried Narcissa out the kitchen door into the cold afternoon and a line of fire. The lady of the mission was riddled with bullets before she could speak a word. Rogers fell dead, Lewis having ducked away on cue. Narcissa collapsed to the ground. A Cayuse man lifted her head and struck her with a quirt, a short, fringed leather whip, an example of which I once saw under glass at the Temastlik Cultural Institute near Pendleton, creepily lethal for such a small weapon, held tight in the palm. Night fell, and the motherless children who'd considered Narcissa as near a parent as they'd ever had remained upstairs together, too afraid to leave despite thirst and hunger and icy cold, furiously wondering what might happen to them. They heard Narcissa cry out, and those who could moved to the window, though there was nothing to see in the dark but indecipherable lumps, one of which was the woman who'd fed and sheltered them when they had nowhere else to go. These children, all girls but one, sucked in the smell of death through the night. The fetid remains of the butchered cow, human entrails hanging from the fence. The children could not help but smell their dying sisters, the pair of girls clinging to the last threads of light and begging for water. Nathan Kimball was still in the room and had dipped a cloth into the only pitcher to clean his wounds, rendering the water undrinkable for children who would die without it. To his credit, the man wrapped himself in a blanket in the wee hours of the morning and slipped off to the river. Before he left, he asked one of the girls to pull out a cotton sheet, tear it into strips, and wrap his wounds. She protested that Mrs. Whitman would be irate if her sheets were ruined. "Don't you know," Kimball told her, "that your mother has no more use for sheets?" 10 minutes later, on his way back to the house with a full bucket, Kimball was shot by a Cayuse scout who called out, one of the children later wrote, "See how I make the white man tumble?" Morning came, and on this last day of November, 1847, dawn leaking in the pale sky, a Cayuse man returned to the ditch to smash in Narcissa's skull, too. This was an assurance, the tribe believed, that the missionaries who'd lived as increasingly unwelcome neighbors for 11 years would be barred from the afterlife they'd so loudly glorified. News of violence at Wai'ilatpu stirred outrage all the way back to Washington, D.C., where legislators made haste to give this newly acquired territory an official name, Oregon, and to hire U.S. Marshal Joe Meek and to assign a governor of the provincial government, George Abernathy. One of the latter's first acts as head of the state was to declare war on the Cayuse Nation. Narcissa's death alone, justification enough to raise an army to strike out in retribution. Thus began revenge on a tribe that did not let up until the Cayuse lost their land for good. They were weak, many of them sick and hiding in the woods. Five Cayuse chiefs turned themselves over to authorities so, they said, the rest of the tribe might be saved. The chiefs were transported to Oregon City and sat through 4 days of questionable witness testimony and scant hours of jury deliberation. It was common knowledge that two of the accused had been nowhere near the mission on November 29, 1947. Several witnesses were also not present at Wai'ilatpu during the attack, but were put on the stand to recite what they'd heard from others. The verdict was a swift guilty. The chiefs were hung without family or tribe present, without ceremony. They were cut down and buried in unmarked graves so that no one could visit a final resting place to pay tribute or to sit in grief and prayer. The grave has never been located again. 5. Even though he was old, in his 90s and ready to go, I dreaded my own grandfather's passing. Still, I couldn't have predicted how unhinged I would feel when this last grandparent was no longer around. Not that I was close to him, my father's father. I wish I'd been, but I wasn't. My belief in him as our family patriarch was nearly biblical, despite my secular Sundays reading the New York Times far from any candlelit pew. As long as Grandpa Bob was planted in Salmon, steady on as always, I was steady too. One June afternoon, when I was 55 years old, my grandfather, who'd hardly ever left Salmon, told my aunt he was going to die that night. The next morning, she raised her eyebrows and greeted her father sauntering into the kitchen. He said a message had drifted in while he was asleep. Furniture had to be rearranged up there to accommodate him, but the wait wouldn't be long. Two nights later, he called for my aunt again, and when she got to his bed, he asked for his alarm clock. He tucked it into the crook of his arm. He woke her again about an hour later and asked for a flashlight. She said, "Why do you need a flashlight, Daddy?" He answered, "So I can see the goddamn alarm clock." By morning, he was dead. The following afternoon, one sister of two and one brother of two and I met in Salmon. I was a grandmother myself, making it unlikely for me to still have a living grandfather as mine had been only hours before. I figured that hardly a speck remained of the girl me who once lolled in the shade of Jesse Creek behind his house, though maybe a few cells clung to the cottonwoods or were suspended in the sparkling mist on top of the water. I liked to think, anyway, that not all sign of me was gone. Soon after I arrived, we climbed into my father's truck to travel across town to see our grandfather. Grandpa Bob was in a box at the funeral home. The lumber store's stamp at one end of the nailed-together plywood, Grade B, in bright orange letters, which meant he wasn't in his rocking chair in the house tuned to the Golf Channel, and keeping an eye peeled for Tiger's Swedish wife, who'd long before split. He wasn't in his shop, or at the Salmon River Inn sipping near beer. He wasn't telling his story about shooting the last wolves, a male, a female, and two pups in their den, or entertaining a crowd with his tale about a bear cub he kept for a day in a suitcase. Nor would he regale us with another old yarn about the two fellers he worked with in a logging camp. He called the pair in this tale Sven and Sven, and told how they'd set themselves at either end of the crosscut saw for crazy long stretches in the Idaho forest, jamming chewing tobacco into the hairy pockets of their underarms, their singlets soon drenched with sweat, the stink and color of diarrhea. The twin Svens, my grandfather said, were ablaze on that wood. They ground their teeth, bulked the rippling muscles of their backs, elbows swinging in and out, wild-eyed from the wet chaw soaking into their bloodstreams and shirts and skin, as, one after another, massive trees around them were reduced to transportable logs. Those were his stories. But now Grandpa Bob was dead at 92, and my brother Ron and sister Cindy and our father walked to the far end of the dank funeral chapel and stared down on the man who'd held us all together, our father shifting from foot to foot as if he thought he could fool everyone into believing he wasn't jarred by a grief that was immeasurable. I kept my distance from him, my father, caution already tingling the back of my neck. In a state of mourning, he could blow up and I'd be a handy target. What was I doing here in Salmon? That's what I was afraid he'd ask me. What makes you think any of this is still yours? I actually live farther west than my father does. Our house is not far from the ultimate destination of hundreds of thousands of Oregon Trail emigrants. The largest migration in this nation's history begun, basically, by Marcus and Narcissa Whitman. After the Whitmans opened the trail, they were the first to transport women and a wagon of domestic goods across the Rocky Mountains, or so it was reported back in 1836. Hordes of others got worked up about traversing it, too, to take up land given over to about any overlander who could manage to ford untamed rivers and hack through the tangled woods to reach the land of plenty. Many of those 300,000 Oregon Trail pioneers were bound for a well-advertised paradise, the Willamette Valley in western Oregon. Here there was no illness, no extreme weather. Here you need only toss in a few seeds, cast grain to the wind, or so promised brochures, coaxing folks out to take up their share of river-bottom land while ignoring the people who'd inhabited said land for generations. Laura Ingalls Wilder, in Little House on the Prairie, expresses the attitude succinctly when one of the settlers in her novel insists, "There were no people. Only Indians lived there." It was all sunny tranquility in the untamed West, if the brochures told the truth. Crops were easy to grow, animals thrived, children prospered. One advertisement even swore that a dead man who'd fallen into nutrient-rich Willamette Valley soil rose again after a couple of days, hale and hearty, better than ever. The home I live in with my husband is tucked in the Cascade Woods. I'm hugged in by acre upon acre of soaring Douglas fir trees and cedar. 100 feet straight up, 150 feet up, up. A couple decades ago, I wouldn't have believed I could be this settled, for back then I resembled nothing more than a frayed electric cord sizzling at the peeled-away end. I'd signed away a bad marriage and swept my four daughters out of Arizona, where I'd attended graduate school, to a new state, Oregon. I thought I could do it all, take care of my kids, support my family on a lousy salary, keep us from danger in a little house at the edge of town. Only to discover that mine were mostly days of failure piled on failure. I was broke and alone. And finally, it was my father who bailed me out by giving me money. I remember the spring afternoon we sat on a bench in a park near my house, his body stiff with his usual sternness that insists, "You better the hell not stay down," while he wrote out a check. Just the same as when we were kids. "Get up, walk it off," he'd say if one of us got hurt. "Rub it hard, you're all right." What I wanted was permission to curl up like a hurt dog, do nothing for a while, but he wasn't one to give it. These days, I stand on our deck in the summer with the woo-hoos of church group rafting excursions bouncing off the river. Osprey chirp and dive in for fat stock trout and keep up this daily hunt until chicks fledge and rainy season chases them off to sunnier climes. Rain falls in the autumn and through the winter and on into spring while I stand on the deck once again, walk in the woods again and again, curious why I still can't get quite right with myself. I have a lot. Kids grown and gone, hours of peace yawning before me, but I churn. I'm a churner. I hike through the land my husband has protected with a rare diligence for half a century, rain dripping off the trees and dribbling from the old man's beard moss, rain on maple leaves, on alder and cottonwood, like a high piano key struck over and over again, plink, plink, plink. At the base of the bitter roots, the valley is dry. The corners feel sharper in Idaho's conifer forests, and the ground crunches when you walk over it. Aspen and spruce grow tall in the summit. I remember stepping out of my grandparents' squat red house, and though I'd seen them 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, gasping at the shining white mountains that pierce a shimmering sky. So near, it seemed to me the peaks might drive right up my nose if I leaned in. The old house my husband and I live in now, in the lush woods, was built a century after the Oregon Trail rush and during the logging rush, and it's far enough west that the Pacific Ocean might lap at my door someday if the prediction of a shattering earthquake comes true. A good chunk of the coast crumbling into the boiling ocean. My father wouldn't mind if that happened, if the western half of our state floated away. He calls it the phony West, populated by socialists. The title of Westerner is ours only by accident of geography. He holds eastern Oregonians across the mountains from where I live in a different regard. This is where the Utah interlopers, Amon Bundy and his followers, held up in a visitor center in the middle of the high desert. The Bundys, who plotted to stay right there, burning the cheese on their frozen pizzas in the center's microwave while occupying a tract of public land until kingdom come. This Bundy version of Manifest Destiny is based on neither history nor fact, and yet, in our new America, it is acceptable. The Bundys and their followers faced few legal consequences. They went home with their beliefs intact, reinforced, and my father approved maybe not of their tactics, but certainly of their vigilante spirit. Snip government, especially the federal government, clean out of your lives. Go at it on your own or die. Let freedom ring. All to say that politics could not come up between my father and me during my brief time in Salmon. They just couldn't, and especially not at the funeral home, please. Nor could I let the other subject that caused an inevitable clench, beginning in my jaw, ending somewhere around my knees, gained traction. That subject being my mother, the person he most loved to hate. She returned the sentiment. I'd lately realized I'd become a punchline to a tired joke. Did you hear the one about the woman well into her 50s who cowered like a child in front of her long-divorced parents? I stood silent as one argued that the other was the villain, the parent to never speak to again if I had integrity or backbone. Thus, I visited when obligation or duty dragged me across the state line, but rarely drove over just to hang out in ease with my family. For 30 years, I made myself as scarce as possible. Now, I stayed silent, too, at the mortuary, lest I say the wrong thing, which is my special inclination around my family. What I wanted, what all of us wanted, was one last glimpse of our grandfather before he went to the fire. Grandpa Bob's body, which looked downright puny compared to his huge presence for the whole of my life, would soon be burned to ash. The essence of him would drift out the chimney to seed the pancake clouds over the Beaverhead Mountains. He'd spill down upon us. He was dead, and our family, the family I rubbed against and held tight to, with its many generations of making and breaking, drinking and brawling, with our habit of forging on no matter what and pissing each other off royally, had lost its center. Now, who would we be? 6. A tale of two grandmothers, one known as Mad and the other as Sad. The sad grandmother was Mamie. Four of her five children, my mother, the only survivor, died at birth from what was later identified as an Rh-negative blood factor. Robert, Ronald, Stephen, Trudy Lou. In my earliest memories of Mamie, she is laden. This made sense to me, that my grandmother had not recovered from four dead newborns in a row, though I didn't ask her about it. My mother said we must never bring up the babies in front of Mamie. It would destroy her. Our mother told a friend once in my presence that our grandmother, after the last infant died, refused to sign her name for many years. She didn't deserve a name. Except a few years ago, I studied my grandmother's sepia-toned wedding picture, a slim and jaunty Grandpa Ron at her side, with both sides of the family surrounding them like curved petals around two tall stamens. And I noticed in that picture, before the pregnancies, before the birth of my mother, my grandmother's face was drawn and taut, her eyes hollow. She was a sorrowful woman even before the great sorrow. I'll never know the cause of the rabbit warren of grief excavated through her body, probably starting from when she was a child, the oldest of four thin siblings scraping by with their parents during the Depression. I likely couldn't draw insight from my grandmother about her blue period of half a century if she was sitting next to me this day. She didn't think in those ways. Grandma Lois was the mad one. Mad as in angry, not crazy. She would not have tolerated having her sanity scrutinized, whapping upside the head anyone who suggested such a thing. Grandma Lois taught English at Salmon High for nearly four decades, specialty Shakespeare, specialty Tennyson, in particular Ulysses, which she recited when prompted by a recalcitrant grandchild or stubborn husband to seek, to strive, but not to yield, and Coleridge. She was well known around town for her rages. She raged inside the A&W drive-in. She raged at the post office. She raged at the butcher in the IGA who'd trimmed too much fat off the chops. My plump grandmother had a booming voice and a wide nose, both inherited from the father she barely knew, a man who left her and her mother and brother in Boise when Lois was a toddler. This grandmother never much liked me. Or maybe she did. I toggled back and forth in the course of a single hour sometimes, trying to decide. Was I in or out with Grandma Lois? She liked my aunt's children and my uncle's children and took them on trips to Hawaii and bought them clothes at the beginning of the school year. And once when my youngest sister was brave enough to ask about a trip for us, and what about school shoes, we were reminded that Lois and Bob had weathered their son and his troublemaking wife through the crisis, a baby too early. They paid the bills while Mike, now a father, finished high school. They helped with his family while their son went to college. And had it really been necessary to produce four children lined up like corn cobs before that golden son was even 21? Enough, in Grandma Lois's estimation, was enough. She had no more to give us. When I first read the story of Red Riding Hood and came to the part about the wolf eating the old woman, I thought, well, it depends on the grandmother. Mamie, all dolefully pleasant, would have apologized to the wolf for being a wisp of a thing, not even a slice of fat to please he who would consume her. My salmon great-grandmother, taciturn Hazel, with the slight crook in her back that made her look like she was fighting a wind, would have stared him down until he laid down his ears and slunk away. Grandma Lois would have kicked the wolf in the nuts, shouting at him to keep that nasty breath of his out of her face. She'd have gutted and roasted him for dinner. I saw her not long before she died, Grandma Lois, her lungs thick now from too many years of cigarettes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.